current that I'll measure is the capacitance times dB dt. So if dB dt is positive, then the current should be positive. So I'll get some value for current. When will this current flip negative? Will it flip negative here, or will it wait until this next stop over here?
Right where you ended.
Okay, right, because it's right here where the slope changes. So the current is going to become negative. And is it going to flip back positive here, or keep staying negative? Stay negative. How about here? Flip positive or stay negative?
It's going to flip positive.
Okay. So my current as a function of time should look like that. A steady slope leads to a steady current. The current onto a capacitor is equal to capacitance times dV dt. If the slope is steady, the current will be steady. Suppose my wave deck breaks and produces a steady voltage of 5 volts after that point right there. So instead of doing the triangle wave, it gets stuck up at 5 volts. What's going to happen to the current onto the capacitor for this region over here? It's going to go 0 and stay there. So the current is proportional to the rate of change of voltage. If the voltage is steady, you get no current. Okay, let's actually put some values in here and calculate the capacitance. So this is going from 5 volts to negative 5 volts. That distance on the horizontal axis is 1 millisecond. And suppose I measure as my current, let's say this level right here is 5 milliamps of current. Okay? Let's actually calculate the size of this capacitor. So I'm trying to get C. So what should I do to get the capacitance? What times what, or what divided by what?
Divide the current by the slope.
Okay. And what is the slope dB dt?
It's a little less than that at the time, or steeper.
So he's trying to get this. Brian's trying to get the slope of that line. Which he's saying 10 over 0.5 milliseconds.
0.25 over 5.
So Ryan's saying the slope.
Or 5 over 0.25.
Yeah, I agree. It's 10 over 0.5 milliseconds. Jodebel is saying 5 over 0.25 milliseconds.
I agree.
Was that the same thing?
Yeah, it's top and bottom both divided by 2.
Oh.
And note, of course, it's the same slope, whether you do change in y over change in x, or change in y over change in x, you get the same slope. So both of those give the same value. So to get the capacitance, we'd solve this relationship. The current is 5 milliamps equals C times dV dt, gives 10 over 0.5 milliseconds. And we get C is equal to 5 milliamps times 5 milliseconds divided by 10, which is 2.5 times 10 to the negative 6 divided by 10, which is 2.5 times 10 to the negative 7 farads. So for the values provided, our capacitance would be 2.5 times 10 to the negative 7 farads. That is a very typical size for a capacitor. A 1 farad capacitor would be considered a huge capacitor, especially for normal lab work. You'll see on, we'll be using some capacitors over the next, all the labs that begin with a 9, 9.1, 9.2, and so on, are all capacitor labs. So you'll get a sense for what typical sizes look like. Just like with resistors now, you have a sense that a 1-ohm resistor would be considered a small resistor, a 1-farad capacitor would be considered a huge capacitor. any questions on how you would measure the size of a capacitor? So if I gave you a capacitor of unknown size, in fact, I did this, it's going to be part of our labs, and this was on the lab final for last year's class. I gave everyone a capacitor wrapped up in tape so you couldn't see what size it was. I said, measure it, tell me how big it is. It's a good lab final exam question because it tests several ideas. First, it tests, are you able to use the WaveTech and the oscilloscope? Are you able to understand what a capacitor is and how you might measure its size? So that's something that we'll be doing up ahead, is trying to be able to measure sizes of capacitors in lab. Edgar?
That was applying the current.
We applied a triangle wave.
Okay.
We applied the BBT.